Okay, so just so you guys know, my name's John Peros. I'm the director of the data management and software development group over here at Hawk Ridge Systems. And I get a lot of questions, during the year about a lot of the different sort of certification requirements, FDA, ISO, things like that. So I wanted to put on this little presentation about the ISO requirements and how Enterprise PDM can help with some of those. The first thing that I wanted to talk about was the purpose of this presentation today. So what I don't want you to think is that if you put Enterprise PDM into place, you're instantly ISO compliant. That's not the way that ISO 9001 works, okay? ISO 9001 has a lot of specifications in them. Some of those specifications, some of those requirements can be accomplished using the tools that are inside of Enterprise PDM. So I went through this whole list of requirements and really highlighted the ones specifically that Enterprise PDM is great at helping with. And those are the things that I'm going to show today. But beyond that, there's a lot of things in the ISO 9001 requirements that have to be done with, say, management decisions and personnel control and resource control and stuff that a software system can't typically handle. So this is only one part of the equation of helping you become ISO 9001 compliant. Other thing I want to put out there is I'm not an ISO 9001 expert. Okay, I did spend a great deal of time researching it for this presentation. And the one thing that I realized is that we've all got kind of this thought in our head of ISO 9001 being this big, bouldering, scary thing. And when I downloaded the ISO 9001 specifications, I think they're only like 36 pages long, and they're not really as imposing as I thought they were going to be. So, ISO 9001 is this body of people across the globe that make decisions on these global standards. And 9001 is not the only standard that they have. They have a bunch of them out there. But 9001 is specifically there to help ensure that you have a quality management system that's effective at meeting customer requirements. And one of the most interesting things I found out is that it's pretty generic. They're really providing you some guidelines and some suggestions about how you should set up a quality management system, but they're not telling you that you have to set it up in an exact specific way that's the same at every company. It's not like an FDA requirement where they practically tell you what color your shoes have to be. They leave this standard open to interpretation so that it can be used by any company in any industry. You're going to take their guidelines and you're going to mold them to fit the requirements of your company. You're not going to have to mold your company necessarily to fit around the requirements of ISO 9001. And it was nice to find that out because it's not nearly as daunting of a task when you look at it that way. The latest release of the standards that I'm talking about today is the ISO 9001 2008 release of the standards. And if you are interested in downloading those, you can get them from ISO.org. I had to pay about $130 for them, but then you have a PDF and a hard copy that you can refer to as you're going through this process of setting it up. There are also many ISO 9001 consultants out there, and you can find a list of those on that ISO.org website. Okay, so into some of the standards here. Just a couple things from the beginning of the standards. The very first specification says that ISO 9001's not there to tell you how to run a successful quality management system that's exactly the same as everybody else. It's just there to give you the guidelines. So kind of like I talked about, it's giving you some suggestions and you can mold your processes into those suggestions however they fit the needs of your company. Spec 0.2 talked about something I found really interesting called the PDCA approach. And PDCA stands for Plan, Do, Check, and Act. And if you read through these ISO 9001 specifications, a really reoccurring theme that you're going to find is monitor and improve, monitor and improve, monitor and improve. They always want to make sure that your quality system is not stagnant, that you're taking the steps to make it better when those steps need to be taken. So they go through this little thing about plan, do, check, act, and how that functions inside a properly designed quality management system. So that was pretty interesting as well. Now, the first actual specification that goes into something that EPDM can help with is section 4.1. And when I talk about these sections, these specifications, I've sort of broken them down into layman's terms. I'm not using quotes directly out of the specifications. I just kind of wrote what the specifications mean in the terms of EPDM. And a lot of times, only half of a specification is something that can be handled by EPDM. The other half is something that has to be handled by people or something of that nature. So these are just the parts of these specific sections that refer to something EPDM can help with. So section 4.1 goes into starting to describe your quality management system, and there's really three things that they focus on. It has to be documented, it has to be monitored, and it has to be improved. And so just with those three things, some of the stuff that EPDM can do, in terms of documented, they want you to have documents like standard operating procedures and all that kind of stuff about how your quality management system is set up. And all those documents need to be controlled in some fashion. Well, EPDM's obviously really good at doing that. It's a data management system, it stores files, it revision controls files, it permissions controls files. That's its job. So all that documentation about how your quality management system is set up is controlled. And as you change the setup and update that documentation, Enterprise PDM is helping you control those changes as well. So that part of the system is easily handled. Now, when they talk about monitoring the quality management system, there's a lot of ways that you can monitor it. You can monitor it with audits, you can monitor it by talking to people and seeing how it's working for them. And where EPDM comes into play is that you can monitor it through the SQL backbone. So Enterprise PDM, for those of you who don't know, is installed on a SQL Server database. And because you've got all that data inside the SQL Server database, you can actually go back in and you can pull all sorts of different reports and queries out of that SQL database. So for instance, if you were curious about how your approval process was working, and if there was a spot in the approval process that documents tend to get stuck that you wanted to improve upon, you can pull all that data out of the SQL database and you can make decisions on how to improve your process. And that leads us to the third point here. You got to continually improve your quality management system. And because EPDM's on that SQL database, it becomes a very scalable solution. It's not like some of the lower data management tools out there where you set it up and then it's very hard to change after the fact. It's a tool that's very easy to grow with you. You can add to your processes, you can make them more complex, you can take complexity out if you find that it's not doing what it should do, and you can make all sorts of changes midstream of the tool without having to worry about affecting what you've already done. So when we talk about improving the quality management system, at least from the software side, it's going to be very easy for you to do that inside the Enterprise PDM tool. Now, we start to get into some of the meat of this stuff as we go a little bit more into these specifications. So, section 4.2.1 and 4.2.2 start to tell you about what the quality management system should have in it. So, again, when you describe your quality management system and you keep all this documentation about how it works, there's a couple of things specifically they say you need to have. You need to have some statements about what your quality policy is and what the objectives of your quality system are. And as you read through these specifications, you're going to see another recurring theme, which is customer satisfaction. So the main objective of your quality management system is typically to provide the customers with the highest level of satisfaction around your product. But you may have other objectives with your quality management system as well. So you need to have those documented, controlled, and stored somewhere that you can access them very easily. Now, you also need a manual for your quality system and your processes in the quality system so that you can train people how to appropriately use the quality management system. And then you need to have documents for all other procedures that are in place around the quality system. Things like how do you check a part for compliance? Maybe you use a CMM machine or something like that. It's not necessarily a software process, it's a human process, but you need to have that documented as part of this ISO 9001 compliancy. So 4.2.2 really tells you that the documentation can be in any form or type of media. So you can have this on a notebook piece of paper that you store in a file cabinet, or you can have this in an electronic copy that you store in a PDM system. Doesn't really matter where you store it, you just have to make sure that it's stored and it's controlled so that it can't be out there getting changed willy-nilly. EPDM, of course, can store any type of file that you have. So obviously, you can keep all that information inside Enterprise PDM if those documentations are in electronic format. Okay, so 4.2.3 and 4.2.4, this is where we start to get into where I can show some examples of the EPDM tool. So 4.2.3 talks a lot about approval processes. Okay, so one of the main focuses of a quality management system is that no document is out in the open for consumption until it's gone through an appropriate approval process. And they don't tell you what your approval process has to be. They just tell you that you need to have an approval process. You also need to have an update and reapproval process. You approve a file, you need to make changes to it. You got to have a process in place for that. You have to be able to clearly identify any changes in a document and any revision changes when you're looking at a file. So these are all things that ISO 9001 auditing bodies are going to look for if they're sitting at your facility doing some sort of an audit. You have to be able to show them this stuff. You also have to prove that there's no unintended use of obsolete documents. Okay, and then 4.2.4 talks about the same thing, but instead of documents, it's focusing on records. And records really are, they're documents, but they're documents that record something about the quality management system. So for instance, if you do a CCB review for the release of engineering files, that's change control board for those of you who don't know, and you take notes during that change control board meeting. Those notes are a record of the quality management system, and you have to make sure that you can control those records much in the same way that you would control other documents. And so, all of this stuff that we're talking about in these two sections is something that you would use the Enterprise PDM workflow for. So, the workflow is one of the really big advantages of Enterprise PDM, especially above the Workgroup PDM tool. Or not having a PDM tool in general. And so I want to get in here and show a little bit about what the workflow tool can do for you and how it will help you meet some of these criteria. So the first thing about workflow is that you can design it however you want to design it. So if we come in here and I look at a workflow is really just a flow chart in my system. So if you've ever done something in Visio or even on a whiteboard, you've created a flow chart of some sort, that's how you create a flow chart inside of Enterprise PDM. That's how you create a workflow. It's really, really easy to do. Okay, and you can create these things to match your specific process. So, in general, approval processes are typically the same, but every company's approval process is going to vary a little bit depending on the departments it needs to go through and this and that. So you can do all sorts of different types and designs of workflow here inside of Enterprise PDM. This one I'm using some parallel processes. Here I've got a very simple approval process versus my more complex process for CAD documents. But you can also have as many workflows as you want. So if your quality records go through one process, but say your CAD documents go through another process, you can have two discrete processes inside the system that capture that information for each individual type of file. So this tool, like I said earlier, is really flexible and really scalable. And how this works on the user side of things is that there's some interaction you can have via the Enterprise PDM tool. So There's two interfaces to Enterprise PDM. There's a Windows Explorer interface and a SolidWorks interface. I'm not really going to talk about the SolidWorks interface today. I imagine most of you on the phone are quality people of some sort. So I'm going to focus on the Windows Explorer interface. And the way that you get into the system, the Enterprise PDM system, is you browse to your C drive and you browse to your vault. I've got this little thing, I call it the Blueberry. And the Blueberry is what allows me to browse into my vaulting system. So I'm going to log in there as John, who in my system is an engineer. Now, the first thing you're going to notice is that I've got these green folders. And those green folders are telling John that he's looking at vaulted data. Now, in the background, I happen to be running a virtual machine. And on this virtual machine, I want to log into the vault as a man by the name of Dave. And so Dave is part of the manufacturing group inside Enterprise PDM. Now, what you'll notice is that Dave has significantly fewer folders available to him than John does. So this is one of our first level of permissions controls, is right directly at the folder level. There's stuff that John can see because he's an engineer that Dave can't see because he's in manufacturing. And as we go through here and I log in and out as different users, I'm going to keep coming back to Dave because Dave is one of those restricted users that should only be allowed to see specific things. And so I always want to contrast what my more advanced users can see with what my more restricted users can see. So I'll come back and forth to this virtual machine as necessary. Okay, so now as John in here, I'm going to browse in my ISO 9001 folder, and I sort of threw everything for this demo in one folder so that it was all right at my fingertips. Obviously, in the real world, you're going to have a much deeper folder structure, but just for the sake of the demo and not having to click through a million folders, I want to come in here. Now, I've got a couple of things. I've got some PDF files you can see that are at the approved state, and I've got some SolidWorks files. One's at the work in progress state, one's at the pending approval state. These are based on my workflow specifications that I've set up. And again, if I come back to Dave and I go into that same folder, what you'll see is that all Dave is allowed to view is the approved files. He has no access to those CAD files because they have not been approved yet, and he shouldn't be viewing non-approved data. So that again is our second level of permissions control. Is that we can control them not only by folder location, but by the actual status of the file. So that's just ensuring that Dave is not going to use or consume data that he is inappropriate for him. So now we'll come back into this, and I've got these files, Bracket, for instance. This is a drawing that I've been working on in my fictitious company here. And so I can come here and load up a preview of the bracket. It's just a very simple thing, so I've got a very simple drawing with it. And you notice that my drawing says for reference only. Now, the for reference only on that drawing also corresponds to the fact that there is no revision in the title block of this drawing right now, because obviously this file has never been released the first time. And this is where the workflow inside of EPDM can get very powerful for you. Because it can control the revisions and the data not only in the system, but that shows up on the physical CAD files as well. So, as John, this file's in pending approval. If I try to do anything to it, we're going to notice that all I can do is say, hey, I need to make changes. I can't approve it. I'm just the engineer, I can't make any changes to it. If I come over to my crank arm that's at a work in progress state right now, obviously, I could take that file and I could submit it for approval. So, as you're going through this workflow process, users are only going to have access to the commands that are appropriate for them. So, if I log out here for a second, and I'm going to log in as Mark, and Mark is the engineering manager in this system, and what you're going to see is that Mark has significantly more permissions to do things than John had, because again, he is the engineering manager. So if I load up this bracket drawing one more time and I go to change the status of it, what you'll see is that now I have an approved option. So I could obviously kick it back to John and say that changes need to be made, or I can go ahead and approve this file and say that it looks good. So if I run this file through an approval, a couple things are going to happen. All right, so I can come in here and leave a comment. nice design. If I can type, there we go. And then we'll send that thing on its merry way. But what you'll notice is that without opening SolidWorks, the watermark has been removed from the file, and the revision has been filled in the title block. Now you're also going to see a session of SolidWorks launch in the background here, and that's what my cursor is doing right now. That's why it's flashing. That session of SolidWorks that launches in the background is going to generate a PDF of this drawing. So as soon as that file was approved, the second it gets approved, we generate a PDF of it that requires no user interaction. So you can see here that it's just going and doing its thing, generating a PDF for me. It's going to put that in the vault, and after that PDF has been generated, I could then send that out to customers. The really interesting part about that PDF is that because the system is generating it, and it's only generating it after the approval process, I can be assured that that PDF will always be the latest version of the PDF that I have available. So we don't have to worry about sending outdated PDFs because the one in the system is always the latest. And that's another thing that you'll see in those ISO specifications is that revisions have to be clearly denoted inside the system. So you can see here I've got a column inside Windows Explorer for revisions, and I can easily see what has a revision and what's been approved. And if we go back to Dave for a second and I refresh his screen, you'll see now that those SolidWorks files are available to them because they are in the approved state. So now that they've been approved, Dave has access to them. I had a good question come in that I want to take a moment to answer, and it said, what about creating other types of generic files? So we automatically created the PDF. Here's a notification that my PDF was created, by the way. You can create any type of file that SolidWorks supports. So PDFs for drawings is a good one. But if you want a step file or an IGES file or a Parasolid file of your actual CAD files, the system can automatically generate those too. So if it's a file save as option in SolidWorks, it can be automatically generated as part of your workflow process here inside of Enterprise PDF. So just keep that in mind as you're going through this. Now, the next step in this was that we wanted to prevent the use of obsolete files. So I don't know if you noticed in my workflow or not, but I had a little dog leg down here that handled obsolete files. So if for whatever reason this file becomes obsolete, part of my workflow, and again, here I'm a manager, so I'm allowed to do this. Not everybody could do this. I could create an ECO or do changes and run it through a revision process again, or I could say, no, we're totally done with this. I want to obsolete it. Okay, in doing this, I can say that the file is no longer viable, send it on its little merry way, and you'll notice that the status changes to obsolete. Now, as the manager, I can still view obsolete files. However, if we go back and look at Dave, okay, and maybe I gave him permission to view these two. It looks like I did. So I gave him permission to view the obsolete files. However, it's very clearly denoted that the files are in the obsolete state. And it's really easy to control whether he can see it or do anything with it based on the permission controls that you set up in the Enterprise PDM system. So if you wanted that gone, we could say, hey Dave, sorry buddy, can't see these anymore, and they're wiped out. It's really easy to set that up, okay? But we're always getting very visual feedback as to the status of these files. So there's never an excuse to say, oh, hey, you know what? I didn't know what was going on with that file. So let's check something else out. We've got an option inside Enterprise PDM, and I want to make sure that that's turned on for our manufacturing users. So if I come into manufacturing and I look at some settings, I've got this option that says, hey, you know what? I only want these guys to work with the latest version of the files. So I'm going to turn that on, and I'm going to show you what that does. So if we go back into our vault, again here, remember I'm logged in as Mark to this side of the vault, who is the manager. I'm going to browse into another folder for a second. So Mark goes into our sales folder, and he's going to look at some presentations. I've got a presentation here that's at revision D. So when I look at revision D, I can see exactly what's happened, but I can also see the history of the file. So if I click on our little history button, we can see basically who did what, when they did it, and why they did it in terms of what's happened through the life cycle of this file. So there's another one of those ISO specs is that you have to be able to track all the changes that are made to a document. So this history tree is automatically generated as you're making the changes to the files and as you're putting your comments in during that change process. So this is all tracked for you automatically. Super easy to show an auditor if you have to. The other thing about this is that as Mark, I'm allowed to see old versions of a file. So if I go and I want to look at all the versions of this file that exists, I can say, hey, we did five changes. We released it to A, two changes to B, two changes to C, one change it went to D, so on and so forth. Now, for Dave, who's a man that can only work with the latest version of the file, A, B, and C we want to consider dead to him. So this is another way to look at obsolete files depending on how you define them. So if we use Dave as our example here and go into those presentations, okay, we're going to look at this data management web content file, same file. Okay, we'll let it load up its preview and grab a latest version because Dave's obviously never worked with the file before, so it's got to go grab a local copy for him. Again, this is how Enterprise PDM works. When you're working on a file, it's always working on a local copy of the file. So you're getting the performance benefits of working locally without having to deal with that server stuff issue. And so if I go and I try to look at the versions, oh, and this may have not updated. I may also have Dave in a couple of other groups. That's unfortunate. Let me check one thing here. Let me just go to Dave and look at this. He should, the way that I wanted you guys to see it is that he should only have the option for D setup. Let's see, always work with latest versions. This may be one of those things where I had to close Explorer and log out of the vault before it would activate. So let me just try one more time here. See if we can get this to show up right. Get version. Well, I'm not sure exactly what's going on here. I'm not going to make you wait while I do tech support, but theoretically, all that Dave should be able to see in this is D, right? So if that option was set up correctly, which obviously I did something wrong, he would only have access to the latest version of the file. So you can control all that sort of prevention stuff via the permissions there inside of EPDM. I should just make sure I am logged in as Dave. I am. Okay, just making sure. All right, so now I did have a couple of questions that came in while I was talking about this stuff that I want to take a look at. The first is kind of going back to the PDF files. When you've generated the PDF or other generic file formats, can it be stored within another folder in EPDM? That's a good question. You'll notice that when I generated that bracket PDF, it didn't actually show up in my ISO 9001 folder. It shows up in my manufacturing folder. So I've told it, hey, I want those PDFs to be put in my manufacturing folder. I also want you to name them with the underscore current revision at the end of them. So you have all sorts of controls over how those neutral documents are created and where they're saved. You can save them inside EPDM or you can save them outside of EPDM, depending on what works best for you. Now, you've also got a question about setting up permissions via groups or users, and you'll notice that I have both in here, groups and users. We definitely recommend setting up permissions for groups. It tends to be easier to manage, but you can do it either way that would work best for you. I've got another question about files being linked into Arena. So Arena is a system that's out there for, they call it a PLM system. The short answer to that is that yes, files can be linked into Arena, and I believe Arena even has an add-in that functions specifically for EPDM. So check with your Arena rep on that, but you can definitely do that. A couple of other questions here. Does everyone using EPDM workflow need a copy of SOLIDWORKS? That's a really great question. The answer to that is no, you don't. You only need a copy of SOLIDWORKS if a PDF or a STEP IGES file is going to be generated. And even if that file is generated, you can have it done as a slave operation. And by that, I mean if you don't have SOLIDWORKS on your computer, it can go find another computer that has SOLIDWORKS that's idle, and it can generate the files then. And if it doesn't find a machine that it can use, it can wait until an idle machine opens up and use that machine. So, no, you don't need SOLIDWORKS on your computer to run Enterprise PDM. Can we give limited access to outside manufacturers? The answer to that is yes, and I'm going to get to that a little bit later in the presentation, so just sit tight for that one. Another question, is it okay to have the revision as a suffix to the file name if the revision's already being maintained by EPDM? That's a good question. For normal files, you definitely don't want the revision as a suffix on the file name. That's completely unnecessary and it'll kind of bark up the way that the system works. But for files like these PDFs that you may be sharing to outside vendors, people often want to have the revision as a suffix because they're sending it outside of the company, and people outside of the company may not have access to your EPDM vault, so they want the revision to be very clear. I've got another question about the differences between workgroup and enterprise. I'll try to touch on that at the end if we have some time. If not, we can talk specifically about that later on. Okay, and I think that's good for questions. So let me keep going through here so we don't get too bogged down and see what we got next on this list. And again, I'll stick around all afternoon if you guys want to ask questions at the end here. So let's see. All right, we covered all this, right? Oh, we do have the update and reapproval process. Again, that's all part of my workflow. Once it gets approved, we can generate an ECO, send it back for changes, and reapprove it, right? It's all using these same workflow branches that you set up in the first place. And revision and file history, obsolete documents. Okay, we got everything on that slide, so let's go on and move to the next one. Section 5.4.2. Section 5.4.2 is pretty easy. It just says, hey, if you make a change to the quality management system, you need to be able to track that change. Now, if you're doing your documentation properly, you'll be tracking your documentation and your system manuals in EPDM, so you can obviously track the changes to those. But you can also discreetly track the changes made to the Enterprise PDM system by using what we call system history. You right-click on a vault, you bring up the system history, and this will go through there and it'll basically tell you who changed what and when they changed it. So we can see here just very recently, I went into Dave and I changed some of his settings as I'm logged in as the admin to the admin interface, right? So that was at 10:31. And so all these changes are definitely tracked as you are making them to the system. So again, this is something that auditors will look for if they're coming in and they're sitting with you to go over a certification process. It's very easy to do inside EPDM. Okay, next on our list here is Section 6.1. And Section 6.1 just basically says that management must provide the resources necessary to implement, maintain, and improve the quality management system. And now, there's obviously not too much I can show here, but let's talk about this for a little bit. So, number one, this whole section, Section 6, is basically about management participation and management buy-in to the system. So, management buy-in to an ISO 9001 certification is a very important part of the process because without management backing, you're probably never going to be able to get something in place that's effective. So, as far as EPDM fits into this system, the first thing that I want everybody to know is that it's a 64-bit compatible system. Just a side note, Workgroup PDM is only 32-bit compatible. It's one of the differences between the two systems. But what that means to you is that it's easily upgradable. So, if you want to start an Enterprise PDM system off very lightly with a very small server, And as you begin to use it more and require more performance, you can add RAM and you can add hardware to that server. And Enterprise PDM will be able to take advantage of those performance upgrades because it is 64-bit compatible. So you can start off with a very low upfront cost if necessary, and then add as the system becomes in greater demand. You can also put Enterprise PDM on virtual systems, and you can put it on hosted servers. So there's lots of options there that can help you fit this into a small budget, hardware-wise, if that's something that you need. The other thing that's going to help you with the investment is that it requires very little day-to-day admin interaction. So you don't have to hire a full-time admin necessarily to run this system. So that's something that can save you money in the long run, and it can save you time as well. So it's a really easy tool to use. You've seen kind of how visual the workflow and everything is. There's no back-end coding or programming or anything that you have to do. It's all pretty point and click. So there's not a ton really of investment that you need, especially compared to a lot of the other systems out there. Okay, so next, section 6.2.2. This says you must maintain all records of training, skill sets, and experience for your employees. So this is one of my favorite parts of Enterprise PDM, and it's something that not a lot of people know you can do. But you can basically create fake files in Enterprise PDM, and then you can use those fake files to create templates that can automatically create other fake files. So I'm going to show you a little bit about what I'm talking about. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go into, oh, I clicked one folder too far back there. Go back in our Blueberry. First thing I'm going to do is create a quality record. So I've got this folder here, quality records. And remember, I talked about records in general as being notes or something about the quality management system that you need to record. So I've created a type of file called a .qmrec. It's just a fake type of file that I created, but Enterprise PDM has no issue with it. And Enterprise PDM has these data cards, which are basically forms that can be filled out about exactly what these documents can do. So here I've just got a very simple form. You know, this is a quality management record for improvement. So what's the improvement type? Describe the description, and then when it got implemented. So let's see how this works. As a user, I come in here, I notice something about the quality management system that I want to make note of. So I do a new record, and I've got two types of records, an employee record or a quality management record. So I can say, hey, I'm going to create a quality management record. What I've noticed about the system is that I want to add a new process, and I need a process to control scrap. Okay, that's the process that I want. So I hit OK. That's going to come through here, and it's going to create my quality control record. So again, I can come look at this record, and I can add additional information if I need to. Hey, I forgot something. Aluminum scrap in particular. Whatever this is, and then I can check this file into the system. Okay, so as we get that file checked in, you'll notice that it goes into a workflow stage called QM Rec Initiated. So again, I've got a separate workflow set up to manage just these QM Rec files. So I can say, all right, look, I want to take this QM Rec file and I want to say it's approved. I'm logged in as Mark, who's a manager, so obviously he could approve it. If I was logged in as a different user, he wouldn't have the ability to approve that. So I can come in here and say the QM rec is approved. Agree with this, whatever your note is. Send that thing in. Goes into the QM rec approved state. And oh, by the way, it just filled out the data card with that information. Mark approved it. He approved it on 222. So let's take a look at something else. If I log off the system as Mark, and I'm going to log back into the system as John, and I'm going to go ahead and implement that for Mark. So I take this quality record, I do whatever I need to do in the background, and then I can say, okay, I'm done with this. So I'll change the state. This guy has been implemented, and put a little note, implemented for you. Hit OK. And guess what? John's name and the date fills out there as well. So these workflows can do lots of different things for you. And then the searching tool that you have in the background is very powerful. You can go back in and you can search for all this different information that shows up on these cards. And that's how you can pull reports and you can pull all this information out of the SQL tables to make sure that the system is functioning the way you expect it to function. I could say, hey, look, show me how many quality records were generated between the 1st of February and the 28th of February. And if you've got 100 quality records generated for process improvement, maybe you know something's not working quite right in there because that's a lot of changes that you need to make. So, all sorts of different things and different pieces of information you can do with this. The other thing that we talked about is the employee records. So, if I want to do a new employee record, just right click, new record. Ah, and look at this. I've only got the ability to do a quality management record. Now, I swear in there before I saw something about an employee record. And it's there, but it's not there for this particular user. John is just an engineer. He shouldn't be creating employee records. So we want to come back into the system now as Mark. And then Mark is going to go through and create an employee record for us. Okay, so Mark comes through, new record, employee record, just like we wanted. And this is just another form that we can fill out. So Mark's going to go through here and he's going to create John's employee record. Okay, and John's hire date was, let's say, January 1st. He started at the beginning of the year. And then you can set these forms up to be whatever you really want them to be. But I've got mine set up specifically for 5 training classes because one of that ISO requirement was that you have to track education, training, and skill sets of the employees. So I can come in here and say, okay, John's had his ISO 9001 compliance class and he's had his personal conduct class. Hasn't had any of his other classes yet. And oh, by the way, he's a skilled machinist and CAD designer. I want to record his skills there. So I've created all this on the employee record for John and I hit OK. And it's actually going to create that record in a specific folder. So we're in the quality records folder right now. I obviously don't want this file in there. So if I go back to my vault and I go into human resources, I can see here that I've got an employee records folder. And in that employee records folder is now John's employee record. If we look at the data card, we can see everything available on his employee record. I'm just going to switch back to Dave for a second. You know, again, as part of a normal user, we don't really want Dave having access to these things. So if he goes into Enterprise PDM, Human Resources, he doesn't have that employee records folder. He can't see that. He's also missing a resume folder for anybody who noticed that. So again, we're controlling the permissions to make sure that they can't see things that they're not intended to see. Okay, so let's keep going here. We go into our next slide, and the next slide is 7.2.2. And this says your organization must define all requirements for a specific product. This is interesting. This is where we kind of come into the data card section of Enterprise PDM. So, requirements could be anything. It needs to be ITAR compliant. It needs to be RoHS compliant. It needs to be pick a compliancy or pick a requirement that you want to have. You can set your data cards in Enterprise PDM up to track all of this stuff. So, for instance, if I go back to just this one regular SOLIDWORKS file, see, this data card has a bunch of different fields on it, and you can control how and when these fields get created. So, for instance, one of the things I could do is say, I really need to track whether these SOLIDWORKS part files are an ITAR compliant file or not. For those of you who don't know, ITAR is the International Trade and Arms Regulations. Basically means you have to be a US employee to work on an ITAR project. But I can come in here and I can use my cards. Okay, and I've got this SOLIDWORKS part card. Okay, this is what's storing my fields on my SOLIDWORKS part card. And I can really easily add a field in here. Let's make it a checkbox. I'll throw a checkbox right there. I want to know if that's ITAR compliant. I can select the variable that I want that to feed into for searches, which would just be, say, my ITAR compliance variable. And then you hit save, and this is now going to show up on all SOLIDWORKS part files. It may not be filled out for files that already exist, because obviously the info wasn't there, but we can see now that the ITAR checkbox is there. And if I was a user who had permissions to do this, I could turn that ITAR checkbox on and off. And what that ITAR checkbox can then do is it can filter it into a different workflow process, it can filter it into different folders, it can help you control permissions on it, it can do all sorts of different things. So very, very easy to set that up. I got a couple of questions that I want to take a second to answer here. First of all, I had a question about the fake file method negates the necessity for creating templates. Not necessarily. You know, I'm using the fake files. I'm creating the template to create a fake file. So, I mean, you could just right-click new and create a fake file yourself. I'm using the template so that it goes through a process and people get a form to fill out. You can do it either way that works best for you. The other question is, can you have this presentation when it's all complete? Like I said, I'm going to post this video up on our website. So as soon as that's up there, it's going to be in the same place that I mentioned earlier. So on the Hawkridge site, if you go to the events tab and then you go to recorded product webinars, you'll be able to find it under the SOLIDWORKS EPDM tab. So this presentation will be available on our website in about a week or two from today. So check back there, and when it's available, you can watch that as many times as you want. Okay, so just to keep chugging along here, I do want to show one more thing based on section 7.2.2. Not only can you control data for the actual files, you can control the data cards on the folders. So if I go into my engineering folder, and I can see I've got project 2010 through project 2018 right now. Let's say I want to create a new project. So I can say new, okay, project structure, and it's going to ask me some questions. Okay, so what's the project name? I'll call it ISO compliance. Give it a project description. I'll just make it the same thing. And we'll say, hey, look, this is an angle grinder project that's a straight grinder. Or, no, you know what, these are all subdependent lists, so if I say sander and planer, I get a different subdependent list. Okay, maybe it's an orbital sander. Okay, we're going to do this thing in the United States, so we'll put that there. It's going to be done in California, which is where I am right now, and the customer for this is going to be ISO.org. I don't know. Oh, and by the way, this is a Rojas compliant project. So when I hit OK, it's going to go and it's going to create my project folder, project 2019, but it also creates a complete subset of folders based on my specifications as well. So here, every time we do a new project, we're going to have consistency in the way the project structure is set up. And if you go and you look at this project 2019, you can see the data card. It's a Rojas compliant project right there on the data card. So I can run a search and I can say, how many Rojas compliant projects did I do last year? And make sure I have the appropriate number of people that are Rojas certified to work on those projects for the upcoming year. It's just all this data that you can keep pulling out of the system that's going to help. Okay, so our next section that we're going to talk about is section 7.2.3. which is that you must have an effective way to deliver product information to customers. And so we have two things here. One of them we've already talked about, which is neutral file generation. So you can automatically generate these neutral files at specific points in the workflow so that you know they're always the latest version of the file. And you can deliver those via email or via an FTP site if you want to use them. However, Enterprise PDM also has a web portal that you can use. So this comes back to the allowing outside suppliers or the allowing outside customers access to your vault. You can definitely do that. So Let's take this example of the bracket that I created. Okay, it was in my manufacturing folder. I'm just going to go ahead and grab it, and I'm going to move it to a different folder right now. So I've got a vendors folder down here at the bottom, just for ease of organization. Okay, and I'm just going to go ahead and paste that bracket file into my vendors folder. Now, I can log into this vendors folder via the website. So I'm going to kick Dave out for a second, and I'm going to use this to browse into my website. Now, this could be a www.website if you're hosting it out. Because I'm doing it on my own computer, I'm just going to use the link to my computer, which happens to be /epdmweb. Okay, and this will browse me, and it's going to tell me that my client is... Okay, well, forget that in my virtual machine. I'm just going to do it on the real machine. Okay, so if I come in here, Hawk, EPDM web, this is what my web client looks like. And you notice that in the web client, all I'm pushing out is the vendors folder. When you set this web client up, you get to choose which folders get shared to the web client. And then obviously all the permissions from your normal vault are still relatable here. You just don't have to share all the vault folders if you don't want to. Like, why would you share the human resources folder out to the web? You don't need to do that, right? So if I come into the vendors folder, it's going to ask me to log in. So I'm going to log in as a vendor. Okay, it's going to tell me it's kicking me out of the local vault, which is fine. And so here's what my vendors can see, right? So the vendors have access to all these different files. You know, they can right click on a file and they can bring up the properties, which could potentially show the data card or anything like that, depending on what their permissions are. So here I can see that I have the data card available to me. And, you know, they can view them as well. So if I have a PDF viewer on my computer, I can do a right click open, and it will allow me to open these files. Well, that's interesting. I think I'm using an old version of Internet Explorer, so I apologize for that. It's like kicked me out. But yeah, you can open those files from the web portal as well. So if you want to go in there and you want to share that data out to specific people, you can create logins for them in their vault, give them the address to the web portal, and then let them go access that stuff via the web portal. So definitely available to do that if you want to. I've got a really good question here, which is it possible to run your EPDM server from a cloud service, and is that advisable? Yeah, it's absolutely possible to run it from a cloud service, and if you're okay with the security level of the cloud service that you're running it on, then I would definitely say go ahead and do that. There's nothing wrong with running a system like this in the cloud. In fact, we're actually working with a company right now to provide hosted solutions to our customers, because it's becoming more and more important for people to have a hosted solution because they don't want the IT overhead on site and they want to be able to access it very freely from wherever they are. I should mention, EPDM has something that we call replication. And just because we're talking about this, I want to bring it up. But basically, replication is something where you can take this vault and you can replicate it to multiple different sites. And so this is actually kind of a cool philosophy in that you can have a server at each location and you can replicate the vault between these servers so that every server you go to will have the exact same live updating vault on it. If you make a change in location one, you can grab that change in location two, even though you're 3,000 miles away. And that's all uptime, real-time replication that you have. So this replication tool in the background of Enterprise PDM, great functionality if you have multiple locations. And even if you do this from a cloud environment, you can still set up the replicated servers if you want even better performance. So there's lots of collaboration options here to help you out with this kind of stuff. Okay, and then let's move on here. We've got just a few more slides. We're almost done. 7.3.1, 0.3, and 0.7. And these are basically just saying that you have to create your development plan. And this is, for me, in the example that I'm showing right now, this is the workflow. But you need to know what your design and development stages are, who has responsibilities at each stages, who's doing the review and the verification and the approval at each of these stages. You have to make sure that everything is approved through this process before it can be output. And if there's any changes that happen to those documents, you have to make sure those changes are reviewed too. So this is all built into that workflow that I showed earlier. And this is how you set it up is dependent on what your process is going to be here inside of Enterprise PDM. Okay, but that's really what those sections are focusing on, is having a repeatable, documented process for design, development, and approval of files. Okay, section 7.5.1 says the information for service must be available, and this can include information that describes product characteristics or work instructions if applicable. So again, remember that EPDM can store all the types of all the different files that you want to store in it. So one of the examples I have here in my vault is I've got a work instruction. So I got this PDF right here that one of my colleagues made. And again, I can preview it here directly inside the vault if I want to do that. But this work instruction is available inside the vault. So if I'm going to put this thing together, or if I'm out in the field and I need a service manual or whatever it is, you're going to be able to have all that data inside Enterprise PDM. And then if you're using a hosted environment or if you're hosting out that web server that I showed earlier, you can grab this regardless of where you are. You don't have to be in the office to grab these work instructions. So all that stuff can be available inside your vault, as long as it's an electronic piece of documentation. Okay, and then 8.2.2 and 8.2.3 really focus on this focuses on reporting. So I've talked a lot about reporting inside the system. I'm just going to take a minute to show two examples of some of the stuff that you can do. Again, because you've got the SQL background in here, there is just tons and tons of reporting that you can do with all that data. I just want to show you two examples. So in my vault, if I go back to my ISO 9001 folder, I've got two little SQL reports that I've already written. So I'm just going to go through those. So the first one is days in the current state. So this is kind of like checking the effectiveness of the workflow process, right? So you've got a file that you think is taking an awfully long time to get approved. Well, you can go and you can check on that file. So I can say, all right, the file that I'm interested in is SW-100-200. It's an assembly that I'm worried about. It hasn't been approved yet. What's happening here? So I can run this query and it can say, oh, make sure we run it in the right database. Okay, this query says, hey, check it out. That file's been in the current workflow state for 21 days. So whoever's responsible for reviewing this file has been sitting on it for 21 days. All right, that I know is an issue in my system. And I could say, is it a personnel issue? Is it a process issue? And we could make the obvious corrections once we get to the root of the problem. But that's just kind of the quick query that you can run. I could say, show me all files in the system that have been in their current state for over 30 days or something like that. There's all manner of reports that you could run out of this information. Okay, this other one that I have is to explicitly show me folder permissions. So this is great for when you have an ISO auditor coming. Okay, so your ISO auditor is going to say, prove to me that in the engineering folder, only engineers have access to those files. So let's take this for a second. Engineering, and we created that project 2019. So let's bring that up. Okay, and then there's a design data folder in there. So this auditor says, hey, I want to make sure that that design data folder is only accessible to engineers. So we grab this thing and we run our query, and this query will go through and it'll say, okay, I missed the folder number. It's project number 2019. Okay, so it's going to say, look, here's all the groups that have access to this file, right? The group all doesn't have any permissions. The group sales doesn't have any permissions, but purchasing, manufacturing, engineering, and the management department can see it. Engineering and the management department have a whole lot more permissions. So this here immediately shows my ISO auditor that anyone in the sales department doesn't have access to this folder, period. But our purchasing guys, they can read the files in there, they can't edit them. So that's just another query that you can run because, like I said, all this data is stored inside your SQL database. Now, I do have an interesting question. And the question is, there's a signature requirement that would force the password function in certain process controls, okay? And this is a really good question, especially if you're in an FDA environment as well. Basically, what it says is that if you're going to approve a file, you have to re-enter your password, even if you're already inside the system. So I'm going to take this crank arm and I'm just going to show you guys how this works. If I change the state and I submit it for approval, you notice what my box looks like here. Specifically, focus on the lower right-hand corner. There's no password requirement right now. So if I take this thing, it's now at pending approval and I want to approve it. Remember, I'm logged in as the manager, so I can basically do whatever I want right now. Now a little password window comes up. Now, I have a blank password, so I don't have to put anything in there, but you can turn this password authorization on and off at different stages in the workflow. And what this prevents is me going to the bathroom for 5 minutes and somebody sneaking on my computer and approving files because, I'm gone, right? They have to re-enter their passwords at critical stages of the workflow. And that's all based on your workflow design. At these different transition areas, you can come in and you can actually turn on this authentication if you want to do that. So that will alleviate a lot of concerns in some of this stuff as well, based on your process. ISO 9001 doesn't necessarily say anything specific about that, but it's just something that could help in your certifications as well if necessary. Okay, and there's one last thing here that we want to talk about, one last slide that I want to go through, and that slide's section 8.5.2 and 8.5.3. And what those two sections talk about is non-conformities of your product. Okay, so you find something that's wrong with the product and you need to make changes to correct that design, to correct that product. Okay, this is handled again through our enterprise PDM workflow, and this is a process that's often referred to as an engineering change process. But you hear it, there's a bunch of different acronyms out there, ECO, ECN, DCN, DCO, you name it, it's probably an acronym to describe this process. But this can all be set up and controlled through your enterprise PDM workflow. So if we come through here and we just look at this one last example, okay, and I'm going to go back to my crank arm and we're going to approve it, right? So this file's approved and we find an issue with it. Someone should be able to come into this system and they should be able to say, hey, we've got an issue. So I'm going to go back to Dave for a second. Okay, let's close this. And we're going to log back into our Enterprise PDM system. And hey, Dave's going to go in here and Dave's going to be like, look, I was manufacturing this file or this part and I saw a problem. So I could create an ECO, right? And now when we create the ECO, it's actually going to fire off a template that creates a Word document and does a bunch of other stuff. I just have to make sure that as Dave, I have access to that Word document. So give me a second here, and I'm going to make sure that Dave has access to those files. Okay, these are just list of files that Dave needs to have local access to. So we'll give him a second while he downloads that. Does anybody have any other questions while I'm doing this local file drop? Basically, I'm grabbing a local copy of the entire vault right here now. So this might take just a few seconds, but want you guys to be able to see how this process works because it's pretty interesting. So if anybody has any questions, I think that I got all of them as I was talking. I'm just looking back through here. Well, the one thing I can talk about a little bit while this is going is the work group versus EPDM differences. So there's a lot of differences between work group and EPDM. If you have questions about that and you want to send me an email after this presentation, I'd be happy to send you sort of like a list of the differences between the two. But basically, what you're dealing with is Workgroup PDM, which is a non-database tool built on a 1996 programming architecture, versus Enterprise PDM, which is built on a database with modern programming architecture. So there's tons of differences between the two tools. We can get into the nitty-gritty. But for instance, Workgroup doesn't have email notifications. Workgroup doesn't show bills of materials. Workgroup doesn't have workflow capabilities. Workgroup can't do task generation like step files and parasolid files, so on and so on and so on and so forth. So the way that you can really look at it is that if you need rev control and that's all you care about, and there's just two or three people, Workgroup is good. If you need anything beyond that, or you have more than, one or two people using the tool, you really should be looking at Enterprise PDM because Workgroup just won't stand up to that test. Let's see, a couple other questions that came in. Are alerts sent to the engineers when there's our approvals and things happen? Absolutely. You might have seen notifications popping up here as I was talking, but basically, I've got a little inbox here, and my inbox is telling me when stuff happens. So, for instance, John took that bracket file and he submitted it to pending approval. I get an email. Okay? Same kind of thing. No, I took it back and I kicked it through and this and that and all the other. So these are all the notifications that I can get when things actually happen. Okay, and that can be sent through the database inbox, like what I'm looking at here, or it can be sent via SMTP to whatever email program you use, so Outlook or Lotus Notes or whatever it is. Then let's see. Oh yeah. I had a nice kick in here when I was talking about Workgroup. Workgroup doesn't do version control either, which is a big difference. In Workgroup, every time you make a change to a file, you have to bump a revision. In Enterprise PDM, every time you make a change to a file, it bumps a version, and it only bumps a revision when your process tells it to bump a revision. So you have significantly better control over the revision bumping inside Enterprise PDM than you do inside a Workgroup PDM. And again, I can talk all day about the differences. If you're interested, send me an email. I can send you a presentation afterwards. So, all right, this thing looks about done. That was my copy of the entire vault, like 2,000 files or something like that. So that wasn't too bad. And so if I go in here and I want to create an ECO for this particular file, so let's grab the drawing, say, hey, I want to create an ECO. Oh, not for the obsolete one, for the crank arm one. There we go. Create an ECO. Okay, I'll say need to add edge brakes to design. Hit all right. Okay, what it's going to do is it can actually fire off. Oh, well, you know what? This won't work because I don't have Microsoft Word on my computer. On this. Well, that's a bummer. I'm going to show you guys this on another file. There again is my notification, by the way. Hey, this approved file was moved to ECO under review. Sorry about that. That virtual machine doesn't have a ton of software on it, and what it does is it actually generates a file in Microsoft Word. So I'll show you that here from a different file on my machine that actually has Word installed. So I grab an approved file, I do a right click, change state, create ECO. And this thing is actually going to fire off a Word document. That Word document is going to grab all the information that it can out of the system about what this ECO is meant to do. Okay, it gives it a number, it knows who asked for it, the date, all this stuff. And then I could fill out the rest of this, hit save, And then I send this file through an ECO process. So it's an ECO under review right now. It gets reviewed, it gets approved, the changes get done, then the changes get reviewed, and it's going through that whole workflow process again. So this is the back end part of Section 8.5.2 and 0.3 that are letting you find these nonconformities and create a process that will allow you to change and document those nonconformities. Okay, so a couple other questions that came in that I want to answer. Let's see. An ECO document by itself can have a workflow and the CAD document. Can these be linked in any way? Right, that's great. That's kind of what I just showed, actually. So you've got an ECO file that goes through a workflow process and a CAD file that goes through a workflow process. And you want to make sure that those files are linked in the process at different times. So if I come into my ECOs folder right here, you can see the ECO that I created is at the bottom of the list, 69604. And so if I check that in, what you'll see is that it's got a reference to the actual CAD file that I created the ECO on. Okay, so what that means now is that as I move this ECO through the process, and let's just say that I approve the ECO, you can see that the CAD file will now move through its sort of parallel process and its different workflow. And that CAD file, if we come and look at it, will actually be at the work in progress state now. And another great thing about that linking is that if I click on the CAD file and I hit where used, you'll see that it's called out in that ECO, so you can always see the link back to the parent ECO. This is all really good stuff that we cover in like a typical general EPDM demo. So if you haven't seen a general EPDM demo, I'd recommend checking out that one on our website because you can get like a good feel for all this little stuff that it does. Let's see. Here we go. Here's an ISO 9001 question. Oh yeah. So this is a good question. It is. How much design can you do on a project before it needs to be integrated into the ISO 9001 system? Can you do things like prototyping without the document control? So, the answer to that is that ISO 9001 doesn't really tell you how much you do in the system and how much you do out of the system. What they say is that system outputs need to be approved and controlled. So they're kind of leaving it up to you. That's what I said at the beginning. It's sort of a general guideline. So they're leaving it up to you to determine what fits with your actual process. However, if you want to keep it all inside the Enterprise PDM system, when you're doing these workflows, you can have little branches of these workflows for like a development process that have very much less restrictive permissions. So you control the permissions at each stage of the workflow. So you can take specific stages of the workflow and give people more or less permissions. That way they can be inside the system, but they're not being nearly as constrained. So that's kind of a way that a lot of people do it. Let's see. Can all of the same revision control and approval processes be done for AutoCAD files? Absolutely. Revision control and approval processes can be done for any file that you want to put into the vault. The difference comes in like PDF file generation. So because this is a SolidWorks tool, it obviously out of the box can do conversions on SolidWorks files. It cannot out of the box do conversions on any other types of documents. However, there are companies out there that have written plugins to do PDF generation for AutoCAD files or PDF generation for Microsoft Office files. So if you do want auto PDF generation on those two types of files, there are third parties out there that offer a plugin that does it. Let's see, another question. Is the ECO template changeable to a specific operation? Yeah, it absolutely could be. It just depends on how you want to set up your ECO process. Let's see some of this other stuff. Okay. Let's see. Oh, yeah. In the ECO workflow, I wrote to the document, not the data card. When I'm writing to the document, I'm actually writing to the data card first. So in the specific case of SolidWorks files, AutoCAD files, and Microsoft Office files, you can link the information in the data card directly to the file itself. So if you input something in the data card, it'll input it into the file. If you input something in the file, it will input it into the data card and it will keep those properties tied together for all of time. Okay, so that's how I did that ECO process when it generated and wrote into the Microsoft file. That's because my workflow wrote into the data card first, and then the data card wrote into the Microsoft Office file. So that's how that thing worked. Okay, I mean, so let's go to just a summary slide right here. I'm pretty much done with what I had to show. Just point out a couple of things. Like I said earlier, just because you install EPDM doesn't make you automatically ISO 9001 certified, but it's going to provide you the tools to help you accomplish that. Okay, ISO 9001, it's not telling you exactly what to do, but it's giving you the guidelines and the goals, and it's up to you to determine how you want to accomplish those. Okay, ISO 9001 requires a lot more than just software. User compliance and management backing are critical pieces of this process. So if you're going to start moving towards ISO 9001 compliancy, you need to make sure that you have your management staff on board with that. And then just the really last thing that I like to point out is that ISO 9001 can be a huge differentiator between you and your competitors. Because what it does is it shows that you're dedicated to meeting your customer requirements. So when you're trying to grab a customer and you're ISO 9001 compliant and your competitor's not, that's going to show that customer that you're taking responsibility for their satisfaction and that you've actually been certified in doing that. So this is a great thing to go after. And like I said at the beginning, it's not really as daunting as a lot of people tend to think it is, especially when you have a software in place that can provide you with so much of the functionality. Okay, so if anybody has additional questions, I'll hang around until I stop seeing questions come through. Otherwise, you can feel free to email me. You guys all got the email invitation, so if you want to shoot me an email back with questions, feel free to. Or you can, call the main number on our website and you can ask for me as well. I'd be happy to talk to you about this stuff. All